Hey everyone, Dr. Hanisha here. Thank you so much for joining me on my podcast, Mahan Health with Dr. Hanisha. Mahan literally translates to great in Sanskrit, and it just doesn't make sense to have anything but the absolute best when it comes to your health. My goal is by you listening or watching this podcast, you're getting just a little bit closer to achieving Mahan or great health yourself. This podcast is all for you, so please make sure to comment what you'd like to learn more about so I can get a guest on the show who's an expert in that field, or I might even talk about it myself. I'm also super excited to announce my new practice, Mahan Health. I will be seeing patients and clients in person in Columbus, Ohio, but I'm also seeing clients and patients all over the world virtually. So make sure to book your free 15-minute phone call today to see how you can start achieving Mahan or great health yourself. Today's episode, I had the opportunity to interview an esteemed colleague and wonderful friend of mine, Dr. Leah Gordon. In this episode, we talk about sex. I remember when we first started talking about sex in our male reproductive health class in medical school, our professor, Dr. Caviola, had a slide up that said, "Let's talk about sex," and our entire class just started singing and jamming to this song, so I had to put it in there. But, all right, getting back to the podcast and why you're all here, let's talk about Dr. Leah Gordon. Dr. Leah Gordon is a doctor of naturopathic medicine, speaker, educator, and founder of Tribe Medicine, an integrative medical practice and educational platform determined to shift the health trajectory of our community or our tribe. She loves guiding modern maidens towards satisfying sex lives, pleasant periods, and conscious motherhood. Her own healing journey, paired with her rigorous medical training, has made her an expert in resolving hormonal imbalances, painful periods, low libido, and poor digestive health. She is especially passionate about the preconception and fertility journey, as she feels this time period presents an amazing opportunity to positively influence the health of couples, their future children, their community, and the planet. Dr. Gordon graduated magna cum laude with a BS in food science and human nutrition from Colorado State University before obtaining her naturopathic medical degree from Bastyr University in San Diego. She lives with her husband in beautiful Encinitas, California now. So make sure to reach out to Dr. Gordon or myself after the show and leave comments below on what you thought of this episode. All right, that's all I got for you. Enjoy.
3, 2. Hi, Dr. Gordon. How are you doing today?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I really appreciate having you.
Oh, of course. Well, thank you for inviting me. I can't wait to have a conversation and talk about all the things we're going to talk about.
Yes, I'm so excited. All right, so let's get right into it. Okay. I ask all of my guests this because I think our stories are what define us. They're what make us who we are. So tell us a little bit about your story. Tell us about your journey to naturopathic medicine and what brought you here.
Oh, that's such a good question. And it's kind of a long story. So I will try to summarize it short and sweet. I have a few different stories of along my path, what has led me to where I am. But my initial introduction to naturopathic medicine was when I was really young. So I was really blessed to be in kind of a work study when I was in middle school, and I was paired with a alternative medical clinic in the town that I grew up in, and they did alternative treatments to spinal surgery. And the patients who would go there, instead of getting spinal surgery, did chiropractic care, physical therapy, lifestyle education, nutrition education. And it was such an inspiring place, and it was the first time, and I was exposed at such an early age to the idea of this is what's being practiced in the mainstream, and like, look at this other option that people have. And I remember patients, like spouses, coming in and like crying and thanking us, like, "You've given me my husband back, you've given me my wife back." They would do treatments with us for, you know, periods of time, like 3-6 months. Like, it was, you know, more of a commitment, but I loved that. I loved connecting with the patients, I loved being with them. And so in that experience, and I worked there for 6 years, I knew after that experience that I wanted to work with people. and then I wanted it to be very education and lifestyle based. And I wanted to get to the root cause of what was going on and offer alternatives to just medication and surgery. And I had never heard of naturopathic medicine. I just knew what I wanted to do. It was like, I had the idea already formed in my mind. And it was actually my boss who presented me a flyer. It was for the school in Arizona. I was a junior in high school. And I literally thought it was a joke because it was as if everyone took my dream profession and put it in a pamphlet. And I was like, no way does this exist. I can't even believe it. And I didn't believe it for a long time because no one had heard of it. No one, you know, I asked around and everyone's like, I have no idea. Like, you need to become like a real doctor, you know, quote unquote. And after I did an extensive, when I went to school for college, I investigated every type of healing. I went to medical doctors, osteopathic doctors, chiropractors, naturopathic doctors, PAs, nurse practitioners. I would shadow them all and learn about their curriculum and what they learned and their philosophy. And I really wanted to understand. I knew what I wanted to do from the very beginning. It was more like which route would get me there. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, naturopathic medicine won. You know, it was just like that was where my heart was. Even though everyone told me to go the traditional route, I was like, no, this is it. This is what I want. And so that led me on the path toward naturopathic medicine. And then I have such a my own journey of healing that led me on the path of why I treat the way that I do and what I treat in my practice.
Wow. First of all, that place where you started working in middle school, which is so cool, how young you were exposed to it.
I know.
It seems like honestly, a magical place.
It was magical. And I do feel like, you know, there's a lot of, I think one of the main determinants of health is having purpose. And I've definitely been blessed and not lacking in that determinant. Like I've always felt like I had a purpose for being here. I was just set up in my life in such a strategic way that like led me down this path. It was like the doors were so like open in the way that I needed to go. Like maybe not in my health, which we could talk about, but in my career path, it's been so divinely guided, you know? Yeah. And it's like, what are the chances of that? That it was just open up to me and I never had any sort of, you know, obstacle that would have led me on this path. And I do feel like it's my purpose and that I was sent here to help in some way and teach or share or heal or something. Like it's just something I feel really connected to. So I'm really blessed to have that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing. Let's talk about, so you did bring up some of the reasons why you treat the way you treat now and the conditions that you treat and what you're doing. Can you go into that a little bit more on why and what you do?
Yeah. So essentially I have my own, you know, journey of healing and a lot of us do for sure. But my flavor of my healing, I basically became the doctor I wish I had had and the person that I would have loved to have connected with at a young age. So let's just start with gut. So I had horrible gut problems my whole life. I just thought that I thought I had brown hair, hazel eyes, and gut problems. Like I thought it was normal that I had, you know, chronic constipation and gas and bloating, and I felt miserable all the time. And I didn't understand. I didn't know until I went to school. And I mean, it really wasn't maybe until even after undergrad that I understood about gut health. And it was after college that I started my own journey toward gut health and looking more closely at my diet and at the microbiome. It wasn't until I went to medical school that I learned about the microbiome and the gut bacteria and the role that that played. And so I've been on my own journey of, you know, gluten-free dietary restrictions. I have autoimmunity in my family. My grandma and my aunt both had Graves' disease. I have antibodies to my thyroid for Graves and Hashimoto's or hyper and hypo. So I was really blessed to have discovered naturopathic medicine before I had a flare that would have pushed me into autoimmunity. So I was able to bring my antibodies down into normal levels after healing my gut and changing my diet. And you know, so far I haven't actually been swung into either of those autoimmune conditions, which is wonderful, but I'm very aware of that. And I practice a lot of lifestyle practices to prevent autoimmunity, but that's a huge passion of mine. So I love reaching women, especially before they move into autoimmunity and catching them and healing their gut and healing their lifestyle before they get triggered, you know, because we know a trigger normally does it. And I was blessed to not have mono or have had like some really crazy infection at a young age that swung me there, but it's definitely on my mind. And then in college, I had a very unfortunate, you know, situation. My first experience with sexuality was not positive, and I was raised Catholic, so I already came from a very shame background around sexuality. And then I had a pretty significant trauma that kind of swung me into a depression, and I had painful intercourse. I had just like a huge slew of problems sexually as soon as I like basically turned 18. And I met my husband not long after that and continued to struggle with really, really severe painful sex, which now I understand was called vaginismus. And then I also had to go on birth control, and I think that that messed up my hormones. So I have like, I've had crazy hormonal imbalances, and I've struggled with low libido for a very, very long time. And I did so much work. I mean, I literally went to any healer, any doctor, anybody you could ever imagine. And a lot of people honestly didn't know how to help me. Very few people knew what vaginismus was. Very few people knew how to help low libido. So I've done a lot of self-exploration and work on my own. And now we're on a journey of infertility. and it's more male factor, but you know, like understanding infertility. So the majority of the patients that I treat are around gut health, hormonal imbalance, low libido, and preconception or infertility. And a lot of that is just because of my own journey and my own struggles with health.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you again for sharing.
Yeah, of course.
Whenever you were talking about that shame around sexuality and how not many people knew what to do when, you know, when you had low libido or had painful intercourse, people don't know what to do. And I think that does have to do with a lot of the way our society or our culture approaches sex and sexuality for women specifically.
Yeah.
And that's why it's always been, we focus so much on male sexuality, right? I mean, all the medications that are out there, anything there, that's all about enhancing men's male sexuality, but there's really not much at all for women.
I know. And
it's really unfortunate. So I'm really excited that you're out here. You're a pioneer in making these changes, having these conversations, because it is absolutely crucial to all of our well-being. Because as you know, I mean, I love the name of your practice, Tribe Medicine. Women are what create the future generations. And exactly. So we need to feel good so that everyone else can feel good.
Exactly. And for me, like, I'm such a root cause person. Like I would say that's one of my biggest philosophies. My two biggest philosophies that I feel like I bring into my practice are root cause and education. Mm-hmm. And for me, I see the name Tribe Medicine to me is like my root cause of how to heal the tribe is to get to women before they, so there's so many like levels of complexity and depth to even how I treat or why I treat, because I'm passionate about preventing illness and sickness and teaching people how to live healthy. And I feel like women before they get pregnant are like the perfect group of people to reverse imbalances that happen when they were children or young people. They can change their lifestyle, become healthy before they have children and epigenetically influence their children. And they make the decisions of what they eat. And, you know, for the most part, the products that they buy and how they interact with their partners or each other. And I just feel like it's such a important time, because if they learn those skills, then they not only influence their families, their communities, but they have that knowledge and that influence for the rest of their life. Like for me, I was able to prevent autoimmunity, which if I hadn't known what I knew, I probably would have already swung into, you know, Hashimoto's or Graves. So I feel like healing the tribe, the root of that is like healing women at that age. But the problem is a lot of them don't necessarily go to the doctor because they don't have cancer or they don't have like crazy menopausal symptoms or anything yet. Right. But the symptoms that are showing up that there's imbalance are period problems. So painful periods or irregular cycles, low libido, which is huge because that's a symptom. Yeah. It's a symptom just like any other symptom. And that can be that there's something off in your mental emotional health. in how you view your own body and the world, with your hormones, with your relationship. It's such a symptom that is important to people, gets them in the door, heals them in that aspect of their life, that then trickles out and heals them in every other aspect. So there's like so much depth to it. I just love it.
Yeah, definitely. And like you said, so I feel like a lot of people just deal with painful periods or heavy periods or no periods, you know, and they just go with the flow with it. But really, these are hormonal imbalances that are affecting our future generations too. And like you said from the beginning too, gut health, that is key to hormonal health. So if you have any gut issues, then that's going to be affecting your hormones as well. And it could be affecting your libido.
Totally, 100%. So I mean, when it comes to like a period, for example, I always say that our periods are Mother Nature's gift to us that gives us every month a check-in on like, how are you doing, right? And the conventional model is there's a problem, get on birth control. You don't have a period, get on birth control. You have a heavy period, get on birth control. And that's basically just like the band-aid. But instead, if we looked at it as a gift that our symptoms are talking to us, like what wisdom is that showing? And for example, painful periods is often caused by a lot of inflammation. Prostaglandins are a big root cause of painful periods. So if you can address the inflammation in your life, not only do your periods become less painful, but like every other aspect of your health improves because inflammation is at the root of almost every chronic disease. So it's just so helpful. And when it comes to libido, again, like these are like conditions that aren't necessarily maybe seen in the conventional model. Is that important? And I think they're very important. You know, how often are people like, let's talk about women's libido. Like this is a big problem. And it is a big problem. And it's, you know, there's just so much huge energy around it.
Definitely. Well, okay. So let's move on a little bit. I know we can talk for hours. So I want to actually get into that libido and that sex drive. Yeah. What are your thoughts on sex drive being a spectrum? Because I've heard a lot about this more recently that I didn't really know about before, on how there can be more women or some women who have a much higher sex drive naturally or normally, and then some women who have a lower sex drive, but it kind of depends on what becomes a problem. Does that make sense?
Yeah. When is it an issue?
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there definitely is a spectrum. There will always be a spectrum for men and women. It's the same. And there are lots of different factors that play a role in that. And one of them could be hormones. For example, a woman who maybe has a higher androgen or testosterone DHEA profile might have more of a sex drive versus another woman who has a higher estrogen profile, lower testosterone. You know, they're going to experience lower libido. So there's the hormonal component. There's also your relationship with sex component. You know, some women were raised in really sex positive households and sex positive cultures, and they see sexuality as a beautiful expression. And, you know, they're very comfortable with that. Whereas other women maybe grew up around shame and like they learned to turn it off. Mm-hmm. And then there's also relationship dynamics. So, you know, for someone who has maybe a normal libido, but now they've been with a partner for 6 months or 10 years or whatever, and there's no desire there, then that can play a role. So when does it become an issue? I would say if you want to have sex, if you want to have desire and you don't, it's a problem.
Right.
So the actual condition of low libido, like diagnosably, is if someone is bothered by the fact that they don't have enough drive. So if someone's like, no, like I maybe am fine having sex once a month and that literally doesn't bother me at all, that's maybe just like what's normal for you and that's totally fine. However, if you want to have more desire, if you want to have sex more, but your mind, your body doesn't seem to be like responding to that want, then that's where it becomes dysfunctional and where you should start looking at what's the root cause of that.
Definitely. Okay. Thanks. I feel like that really helped explain when it actually is a problem, because I do see women with different levels of sex drive frequently, and sometimes it's hard to know, like, okay, I ask them, like, do you have the desire?
Yeah.
But sometimes it does end up being like the partner has the desire because they may be on another part of the sex drive spectrum, and then yeah, they're on another side. And I think,
yeah, and we can get into that too, because sometimes women think that they don't want it, because that is what low libido is that they don't want sex, but right, it's like, are they happy with that? And that could be even in a broader spectrum of, is your relationship that you love happy with that?
Yes.
Because if you're committed to a partner and they want to have sex, you know, once a week, and you want to have sex like once a year, but you are loving and committed to that relationship, is the unit as a whole happy with the fact that you only want to have sex once a year? If it's not, then it might be something to look at, because maybe that's not normal. You're just like so shut off from it, you don't realize.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Yeah. Okay. One of my other questions, this is also kind of a broad question, but I feel like societal impacts have a lot to do with sex and sex drive. And so, and recently, I mean, maybe in the last 100 years or so, maybe a little bit longer, we've had more of a push towards a more masculine energy society, because we're such a patriarchal society, and there has been this push in a way. I mean, I know I even felt this personally, that I need to be more like a man in order to succeed. Mm-hmm. And so then suppressing my feminine energy, but really our feminine energy is what helps us create. And how do you think that shift has affected sex and sex drives in general?
Yeah, I think it's affected it substantially. And I actually think that the suppression of female sexuality goes back even many more centuries, around the times of the witch trials and things like that. Like, I would say maybe in the last, you know, few hundred years, it's been a big problem. And when we look at our last, you know, 100 years, you're right. Like, we are very much in a male, or not even male, it's masculine. It's masculine energy. Masculine and feminine doesn't even necessarily mean male, female. But for instance, and I get into this a lot around the masculine and feminine dynamic, which plays a big role in libido in relationship. So to highlight, to explain what you're asking, let's just say I'm a female and I was born with more of a feminine essence. And females can be born with a masculine essence or a feminine essence. But a feminine essence is creation. It never ends. It never dies. It's like nature. It's things that go around and around. It's dancing. It's just like beauty for the sake of beauty. It's just being in the flow. You know, it's just this kind of softer, you know, anything that you kind of think about is like nurturing and that kind of energy. Whereas the masculine essence is schedules, to-dos, deadlines. It's ultimately the overarching theme is actually death, whereas the feminine, the overarching thing is like life. And so life never ends, whereas in the masculine, it dies. And that example could be like, my husband wants to end the conversation and solve the problem, whereas I just want to like talk for the sake of talking, you know? And so our society is very masculine in the sense that we have calendars and timelines and deadlines, and we have to get from point A to point B, and we have such a running list of to-dos, and it's, you know, in charge, and like there's just so much there. And let's say like I'm a female with a female essence, and my husband was maybe born with more of a masculine essence. But I'm an entrepreneur and I'm in this masculine dominated society where I'm running a business and I have 1,000 things to do and I don't have time to be free flowing and creating. I need to like get stuff done. And so we both come home and we're both in a masculine essence. You know, he's been going in society. I've been going in society. We now no longer have any polarity, because to have passion, you have to have the polarity of the masculine and feminine essences. And I find that that's a huge factor in low libido in relationships, even beyond hormonal imbalances. It's really understanding your masculine and feminine dynamic. And that can play a role in society. And it can also play a role in just your own sexual desires and fantasies, if that makes sense, which we can talk about. But yeah, absolutely. I think society has shifted us more to be like everyone's in the masculine kind of. But then there's also the extremes on the other end. So maybe you're in like more of a conscious community, you're in more of like a yoga, you know, vegan, like free flowing community, and both you and your partner in that, you might both be in the feminine essence, right? Mm-hmm. So it can happen. It's not like masculine is bad. It's just, are you both in the same? And yes, as a general rule, I would say our normal society is definitely more masculine focused.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it's similar to what we were even talking about before, about how it's such a process or struggle to have all these deadlines for us. And we're like putting all these things together, especially as entrepreneurs now. And that's what I think about constantly, is that this culture is like promoting this very masculine, mm-hmm. dominated energy. And in a way, like you said, I mean, without these calendars and deadlines, we really wouldn't get much done. Like, it would end, you know, like you said, I really like the way you put that, with the masculine energy, there's an end to it. So like if we were the way we think, it would just like constantly be creating and all these ideas flowing through our minds.
Totally. Yeah. Productivity is very much masculine energy.
Yeah.
But creation is very much feminine energy. And right. So it's learning, and as entrepreneurs too, or anyone who's creative, it's learning how to balance. Mm-hmm. You have to master your masculine and foster your feminine, is what I always say. And you really have to know when to turn one on and when to turn one off, because you do have to tap into that feminine energy to create, but then you also have to tap into the masculine energy to put it out into the world, or to like actually get it out there. Because like, if ever you've met someone who's very feminine essence, they might like make beautiful things, and maybe they're an artist, and like they just always have downloads, they always are creative, but like they never actually get anything done, right? Right. So it's a balance. It's always a balance.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And like you said, we each of us need to have a balance of both. It's not necessarily that we, as a woman, we have to only be a part, have that feminine energy. No, we should be having both the feminine and the masculine. And it's the same thing for men as well, having both the feminine and masculine. And I like what you said about being able to turn it on and off and knowing.
Yeah. And when it comes to libido, this is such a huge thing, is to be aware. So there's so much self-awareness in libido, especially in a long-term relationship, because it's learning what is your innate essence, what is your sexual essence preference, which I can talk about, and then how do you know how to foster one or the other so that you guys can be in opposites. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yeah.
So like, let me give you an example. So for me, I know how you can tap into what is your sexual essence is really what's in your fantasy, right? When you imagine your sexual experience, or what, you know, turns you on, or anything that you love, are you more in the giving mode, or are you more in the receiving mode? Mm-hmm. So the masculine is the giving, and the feminine is the receiving, which you can look at physiologically, right? The man gives a seed and the woman receives the seed, like the sperm. Mm-hmm. In sexual energy, the masculine is more maybe in charge. They like call the shots, do everything. Like, I'm going to open the door for you. I'm going to take you out to dinner. I'm going to pick you up and put you on the counter and kiss you. Like, I'm kind of calling the shots, right? That's masculine energy. Feminine mm-hmm. energy is receiving. I like to just be whisked away. I like to, you know, not know what's going on. I like to be pushed down on the bed or whatever. And so in your sexual fantasy, where are you? Are you in the giving, or are you in the receiving? And it's important for you and your partner, if you're in a relationship, to understand those essences and to know whoever has the lower libido. It's important to create a container that allows for your sexual essence to be fostered. For example, like, and I think a lot of the problem today is that people are more balanced. There are a lot of men who maybe have masculine and feminine balance. This is the case for my husband and I may be very feminine essence, but I work all the time, so I'm very masculine. So we might come home and we'll both be in our masculine, but I have to be in my feminine to get turned on or have a libido. So we have to create the situation that allows me to be in my feminine, which means he needs to know that he takes me out to dinner. He calls the shots. He kind of does that stuff, and it allows me to step into my feminine. And I come home and I like don't talk about to-dos. I don't do, you know, the to-do list. I put on something beautiful that makes me feel good. And like, you kind of just are aware of how to shift into your opposites.
Yes.
Yeah.
I really like that. So, So talking about that sexual essence and the fantasies, I feel like that's not something many people talk about. So I really appreciate you bringing that up. Yeah. And I didn't know about the giving and the receiving. That's really cool. And like you said, it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. Think about it. And I'll just share this personal story too, because it's not always boy, girl. I just happen to be more of a feminine essence female, but my husband's sexual essence is actually female too, or feminine as well. So he wants me to push him down on the bed and call the shots, right? He wants me to be the goddess diva. And yeah. I want him to be the masculine man. So we had a lot of incoherence at the beginning of our relationship because we didn't understand this. Mm-hmm. Because we both wanted to be in our feminine essence, right? And so now we know that I just have to start out feminine essence and then I can switch once I'm engaged in sexuality and when I'm feeling good. But we can't both be in our feminine essence right at the beginning. Yeah. Don't create the polarity and you don't feel the passion.
And I guess that's a good point too, because it sounds like you can have both, even in your sexual fantasies, right? And I feel like there are a lot of people who do have both. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, both of them, either one, it depends on their mood, right? It depends on what they're feeling. Probably, and it sounds like it really depends on which essence they're in. Are they in the more feminine essence or the more masculine? And depending on that situation, what would they like to be giving or receiving?
Exactly. And that's very clear. And that the trick to it is literally to just know the difference between them and to just be conscious that one of you is in the opposite at all times. That's basically it.
I love it.
Yeah.
Okay. So what are other things? So I love that we talked about the main concept of it, the fantasies and the essences. What are some other things that people can do to work on their libido more naturally?
Yeah. So, well, first of all, there's a couple root causes. Let's just highlight them, because whatever your root cause is will impact it. So for one, let's start with hormones. A lot of people like to go to hormones. So that would be a physiological root cause of low libido. So that could be something like low testosterone. This is super common when someone's maybe been on birth control. Birth control raises a protein called sex hormone binding globulin, and that binds testosterone, which is the hormone that helps you have a sex drive. So getting that checked and just seeing, is that what's going on for me? This is why so many women have low libido on birth control. But it can happen even after you get off birth control. So that's the case for me. I have incredibly high sex hormone binding globulin, the highest I've ever seen. And I run a lot of labs. So unfortunate, but it's there. Also, another really hormonal root cause is low DHEA. And this is a hormone that we make in our adrenal glands. And this goes down when we're stressed. So, you know, having stress reduction practices, I know that it sounds so cliche, but it's just the root of all things. But getting that checked can also help to know, is that what we need to work on? And there's different herbs, there's different, things that you can do to address that. Outside of a physiological, there's actually what I call negative brain training as a root cause. And there's a lot in that. So that could be growing up in a religious household that's not sex positive. That is having shame growing up, having a history of sexual trauma, having performance issues. So this is big for men, men who have a hard time with libido, but women too. Just having any sort of negative association or experience around sex. So if that's the case, you know, maybe doing counseling or therapy or self-work to kind of unravel that. And then there's also, stress in general is just, that could be its own root cause. So really practicing pleasure and getting into your parasympathetic nervous system. And then the other one is misunderstanding. So we put women in the same category as men when it comes to sexual arousal and sexual everything. And that's just not correct. We are different on many levels. For example, this is a big concept for people to understand, is responsive versus spontaneous desire. So libido or sex drive, the desire to want to have sex, is something that can happen spontaneously, or it's something that can be fostered, and it's something that happens after it's been kind of invoked out of you. So spontaneous is what most men have spontaneous libido, or high libido women. So this is, I wake up in the morning and I want to have sex. Or I see someone walking down the street and I'm like, oh, I'm turned on now. It's just spontaneous. It just happens. And so a lot of people don't have that and they think that there's something wrong.
Right.
But most women experience responsive arousal or desire. And that is, I maybe don't feel sexually anything, but if you speak to me in my love language, or if you start talking or touching me in a way that feels really good to me, then all of a sudden I start to develop desire and feel like I could maybe get into this. But that doesn't happen until you start that.
Mm-hmm. This is what happens. Is so important.
Yeah. And so what happens, most women are like, no, I'm not in the mood. So it never gives them the chance to ever cultivate that. And so they don't ever really feel like they have a libido, but their libido actually doesn't start until the initiation process starts. So men aren't taught that. A lot of men are raised on porn in our society, especially the millennial generation when the internet was out when they were young. And porn is just like a fantasy. It's just like reading romance novels for men. It's not real life. It's just a made up, make-believe thing. It has nothing to do it has nothing to do with what actually happens, but that's how they're taught. This is what we do. Women should just be ready to go like I am. And that's just not the case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you for addressing that, because that is another huge issue, because that is, porn is not real life. That is not how things work.
And I heard this thing from someone, I can't remember who it was, but I thought it was brilliant. So basically porn, and you know, men are very visually stimulated. Women are more stimulated by the situation or the story and the buildup, the anticipation. Men are very visually stimulated. So of course, a lot of men, you know, look toward porn, but it's the equivalent of a guy sitting in his living room in the dark, watching football, lots of football, all by himself. And then the next day going on the field of a pro team and expected to play football. It's not the same. Just because you can watch it and just because that's what you see on TV, it's very different when you have to actually be in it.
Right.
And we just don't have skills. Like, no one's taught that. Like, who teaches our males or female partners to pleasure females? No one does.
Yeah. I mean, even in the media and stuff, you see so many jokes and things about men pleasing themselves, but there's never even any conversation around women pleasing themselves. And that's a whole nother thing that we could have a whole nother hour long conversation.
Okay, we could talk about this forever. Before I forget though, there is this awesome company. It's called OMG Yes. And they went around and studied women and their sexual response and arousal. And they've created videos and teaching abilities to teach us, like, this is how women actually like to be pleasured. And this is what it is. So I think that it's great that there are people out there starting to do stuff like that, because it's so needed.
Yes, I love that site. I do refer a lot of people to that site, because it's so true, because so many women don't know what to do. And then in a way, by empowering yourself, you can even tell your partners what you like and what you need. Yeah. And most men are receptive to that. And if they're not, we should probably talk about getting rid of them. But yeah. They should be receptive. Your partner should be receptive to pleasing you.
Exactly. Exactly. A lot of it's misunderstanding. They just don't know how, and most women don't know how either, or they don't feel like they can ask for it, or they don't even know what to ask for. So again, there's so much of a need to have this conversation and talk about it. And yeah, it's so important.
And I'm so excited that you're talking about this.
I know. And it even goes deeper, because sometimes I'm like, to people who are like, why do you talk about sex? And it's like, well, for one, just the sake of sex. One, it's pleasurable and that's amazing and we need more pleasure as humans. Two, it's actually very, very helpful. Like, the Taoist tradition always talks about sex as one of the foundations of health, because it moves qi and sexual energy and all of this like amazing healing power. But then also, if you're in a relationship, most relationships fail because of sexual issues or money. Yeah. And, you know, if we really want to raise children with like strong foundations of, you know, family units that stay together and that foster love and relationships, like, the sex piece needs to actually be working, because a lot of marriages dissolve because it's not. And so it's not just about sex. Like, it's so much more than that. And it's a cultural thing that needs to shift too.
Definitely. I mean, like you said, the Taoist philosophy and most ancient medicines that we learn about, they do talk about sex and as a huge part of health. And so this is one really key piece that we've kind of suppressed.
We've definitely suppressed it, or we just made it fearful. Like most of us, the extent of our sexual education is that if you had a religious upbringing, that it's a sin or that it's bad, or if you were just taught in the school system that it's dirty and that you can get STDs or get pregnant and that's the worst thing ever, so don't ever do it. Like, that's it. That was our message.
I love the Mean Girls, that little clip. I don't know if you remember that, where they're pretty much like, don't have sex. If you have sex, you will die.
And oh my God.
Just like sex education.
I mean, that was basically my sex education. Right. It really was. And I was so afraid of it. It was so scary. And, you know, and then when I did actually have my first sexual encounter, it was scary. It was as awful as they told me it would be, you know? And I was like, wow, talk about brain training to like reconfirm that that's what it was. And it's like, that's just not the truth. And it's, And if I had had more training and power in myself, you know, I probably could have avoided that situation. But it's like that I could talk about a whole other time. I'm here to empower other people to do it. So,
yeah, exactly. Love it. Okay. So before we move on to the rapid fire questions, do you have any other resources or any other things that you'd like to, you really like to bring about and tell our listeners about?
Good question. Well, I'm actually working on developing a course on low libido and relationships. It's not out yet, but if you go to my website, you can get information about it. Other than that, some other good resources. There's a book, which I'll give you in the show notes, but The Anatomy of Female Arousal is a really great book, which will teach you about like the actual anatomy of female arousal. Esther Perel is a great option for looking. She does a lot of teaching around relationships, and she teaches a lot about individuality in relationship, the idea of thrill and mystery. So that's another great option to look into. Gosh, there's so much. Yeah, I mean, well, actually, there's not so much, because that's why I feel like I need to share this, because I'm like, that's about, I'm like, is there anything else that I can think of, though? Yes, is a great resource, but there's a big need for more.
Definitely. And so, yeah, like she said, we'll have all of this in the show notes too, so that you all have access to that information.
Perfect.
All right. Moving right along to the rapid fire questions. The first question that I ask all of my guests is, what does Mahan Health mean to you?
That's such a good question. So I feel like, because I've talked a lot about purpose and I clearly feel a lot of passion for what I do, I see health as a vehicle that allows us to bring our gifts or our purpose to this world. So, you know, I have this kind of question, like, why do we even care about health? You know, why do we care about it? What does it even mean? And like, yes, it makes us feel good. But for me, on a greater level, having great health or Mahan Health is having the ability to bring to this world what you are meant to, whether that's a family or children or doing the best you can in your work or bringing a message or teaching or whatever it is. I feel like we all have gifts that we were given when we came here to share with the world and make it a better place. And having great health allows you to do that. You know, if you get sick and you can't get out of bed because you're so exhausted, like, how do you share your message with the world? And so for me, it's all about cultivating that balance and that healthy, vital body and mind so that we can bring whatever we're meant to bring.
I love it. Yeah. Mahan Health helps us bring the gift that we were meant to bring to the world, I love it. All right. So next question. The next two questions kind of go hand in hand. What was the most difficult health change for you to make, and what are you still working on personally?
Good question. So I would say, if I look back at my overall journey, the most difficult was probably changing my diet and eating gluten and dairy free, which I do for my gut health and to prevent autoimmunity, because I was raised in the Midwest where like the only vegetable I ever ate were like peas and corn, which are not vegetables. And we ate gluten and dairy in every single meal. I was obsessed with toast. I ate it like all the time. My mom was a great cook, but it was all like gluten and dairy. And I literally didn't even know how to eat when I went gluten and dairy free. I thought I was going to starve to death. It was just traumatic. I was like, I can't eat the bread at the restaurant. And like, it was just really hard at the beginning. Now it's totally fine. I'm totally fine with it. But that was a huge shift for me. It was a big paradigm shift. And mm-hmm. it took a lot of knowledge and education and mindset shifting. And it's better now. What I'm still working on is a routine movement practice. I used to move all the time until medical school when I sat all the time and was exhausted from late night shifts and my adrenals were just like struggling, even though we did the best we could. You know, we're definitely more aware of it in naturopathic medical school, but I got out of that routine and I feel like it's something that's so important. One, for libido, another tip, if you have low testosterone, working out, especially lifting like weights for big muscle groups like your legs and glutes, very helpful. So I'm working on having more of a regular movement practice. That's my focus right now.
Great. Yeah, I can definitely relate on the Midwestern diet. Very difficult life shift over here as well. Yeah. But all right. So then the last question is, if you could have a commercial about health on anything that you like, it's going to be on national TV and it's more of a PSA. You're not necessarily selling anything. What would it be about and why?
Okay. Good question. So I don't know if this is a commercial, because it would probably be more around like education, but I would basically like, if I could get into everybody's TV for, you know, 2 minutes, I would quick rapid fire tell them all the secrets that they don't know, which is that like almost all of your suffering and disease comes from like your diet, infections, your mindset. We have the tools to change it. There's so much natural medicine that we can do. Love yourself, love each other, like basically all the secrets to health, which isn't that complicated. It's like we just don't think about it, you know, way more than the commercials that are like, take this medication and cover up your symptoms and hear all the side effects. I'm just like, if you only knew why it was doing that, like you can fix it. So I would probably, and then like toxins, you know, I would totally be unplugged by all of the networks because they probably are all owned by all the companies that promote that. But that's what I would do. Be like, clean up your life really fast, rapid fire. This is the root cause of everything.
We can help. You can change
everything. Yeah, we can help.
Yeah, I love it. All right, so last thing, where can people find you? They're looking for you.
Yeah, so you can go to my website, tribemedicine.com. I have some freebies there that you can download that'll help you out. You can get connected with me. And then Instagram at tribemedicine.com, or not .com, just at tribemedicine. And then my personal Instagram handle is at Dr. Leah Gordon.
Okay, great. And again, we'll have all that in the show notes. So thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Gordon. Really appreciated having you and had such a great conversation. And I hope to have you again soon.
I would love that.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you so much.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
I hope you all enjoyed that episode and now hopefully have a better understanding of female sexuality and all the intricacies of what that really entails. I will have Dr. Gordon's information and the resources she mentioned in the show notes below, so make sure to check those out. And that's all I really got for you today. Wishing you all Mahan or great health, and I will see you next time.